Oh man, thank you all so much. How we appreciate that. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Grace United Methodist Church. To all who are joining us online and to all who have gathered here in person, wow, what a powerful way to begin our day of worship. Welcome where we gather in Christ's name. I welcome you in his name and so glad that you're here. To those of you in person, if you'll just take a moment and please sign the registration pad. That's the notebook that's found in each of the pews, and pass that along to the person beside you. And those of you joining us online, if you would put your name in the chat, if you haven't done so already, we're honored that you have taken this time to be with us this morning. So much is happening in the life of the church, and I give thanks for each of you. Your faithfulness is what helps the ministries unfold that we have here at Grace, that we are part of in the world. For example, we know that our hearts are heavy as we think of the people in Turkey and Syria. Last report I had this morning was over 28,000 people killed from earthquake. And so we are thinking as a connectional church, how can we be of help in addition to our prayers? If you go online to umcor.org, you can send in your financial gifts, and this will help with the relief effort that is taking place. And if you are not computer savvy, please, you can just send those checks or drop them by here at the church and earmark those for UMCOR, and that will go towards this relief effort in addition to our prayers for all affected. That's connectional ministry. That's where, as a church, we can help lives many miles from us, but we know our brothers and sisters in Christ and are who in need. I give thanks for the ways that we are being the church locally as well. I was just reminded of this weekend. Just being able to gather is something we certainly do not take for granted anymore coming out of COVID. Friday night was our youth and kids ministries lock-in. We gathered for our spaghetti dinner and we had a fun time, followed by a game night and followed by a lock-in where I don't think a whole lot of sleep took place. They look energized there, but I was talking with some participants. They went to sleep about 5 a.m. and were up for our men's breakfast at 8 a.m. yesterday morning. So it was probably quiet afternoons in many of your households. But nevertheless, it was a fun time of fellowship. And then at our men's breakfast to have Amy Warfeli, who shared with us our lay leader about her experience of being a volunteer at the border in El Paso last month, and just an incredible time of sharing. This all took place in a gathering, and the meal itself raised funds towards our work camp, which will be a blessing to our team going on their mission trip this summer. That's being the church, and that's the church that you are part of. So we're going to continue in our times of ministry together. Lent is just around the corner. And so we'll be gathering online for our Lenten series. This is our Wednesday night series from 6:30 to 7:30, the same Zoom link that you used to get here to this morning's service. That will be starting in March. On Wednesday night, Ash Wednesday, we will be gathering for our first Wednesday night worship service of the Lenten season, an Ash Wednesday service. Before that is Shrove Tuesday, is our pancake supper. So you are invited. Tickets are on sale already, and we hope that you'll be part of this special time of fellowship. As the church, we continue to refine and look for ways that we can be most effective. That's why beginning this last Sunday of this month, note, we'll be adjusting our worship times. This service that you are currently at will be at 10:30. Our day begins with our 8 o'clock worship, followed by Sunday school at 9:15, and so we are working on offering classes for elementary age youth, and we have our adult classes, and we'll be having some new opportunities for small groups that will be starting in March. And in March, we'll be bringing back our coffee hour, so if you come to 8 o'clock, you can stick around for coffee, or you're coming for Sunday school, we'll have this wonderful time of fellowship throughout the morning, so that will be taking place. Notice that Sunday school is not concurrent with worship. This is giving our youth opportunity to be in worship as well. And for those with elementary age children, what we're going to be doing is during this service, we're going to have our parlor available where the service can be heard, and we're going to have some crafts and other activities. So if a little one can't make it through this service, while you'll be in, that's just over here to my right here, where you'll have opportunity to gather. So all these things are being put in place. Much is happening, so I wanted to spend some time with you this morning and ask for your prayers and look forward to the ways that God will continue to work through the life of our congregation. And now, as we continue in our time of worship, I invite you to join me in our call to worship. Are you awake? Are you alert? Christ is coming into our lives in a new way. Are you watching the signs? Are you interpreting what is happening today? Christ is coming into our lives in a new way. Do you see opportunities for ministry? Do you see the poor, the homeless, the hungry, the needy? Christ is coming into our lives in a new way. Come, let us worship and let us work in the reign of God. Christ has extended the invitation. Let us work together in the reign of God on earth. And now I invite you to pray aloud with me. Come, Holy One, teach us your ways. Lead us in your paths. Guide us on our journey. Speak to us your words of life, for you offer us direction and wholeness when we hear your voice and follow. You bless us with your love, shower us with your grace, and help us grow in faith. We seek you, O God, with all our hearts. Be near us this day. Amen. Now I invite all who are able to please stand as we join in singing our opening hymn, The Church's One Foundation. The words are found on page 546 and on screen.
Share through faith communion with those who rest in
Please be seated. Thank you. At this time, I'd like to say a special good morning to all of our children who are joining us online and to all who have gathered here and to all who are here in person. Would you please join me up front for this morning's children's message?
Good morning, everyone. Good morning.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
How's everybody this morning? You're all rested? Several of you, takes a little while. Yeah, when they say a sleepover, sleep doesn't really happen. No, I think so. But you had a good time, and that's what counts. We're so glad that you're here and part of all that we're doing here at Grace with our children and with our youth ministry. Well, do you recognize what I brought here today? All right, now don't judge the artwork too much. Okay, all right, it's the best I could do, all right. I had some assistance, I confess. So why would I be talking about a heart today? That's right, Valentine's Day coming up here, and so it's a special time. Now, I know it's Valentine's isn't a church holiday or holy day, but it talks and it celebrates love, doesn't it? And that's something our world needs to know about, and so I think that theme of love is very important. And when I think about love, well, we think about God, don't we? God is the source of love. And so we want to be careful because sometimes a day can be exclusive if we're not intentional about it. For example, I remember being in youth group. Okay, it's been a few years ago, but I was in youth group, okay? And for Valentine's, and there were some in our high school group that were dating, but most of us weren't. And so what we would do is we would go to a restaurant where you actually get to sit down with a menu and be waited on. So that was a big, so we'd go to like an Olive Garden or something like that, okay? But it was still, it was a big deal then. And we would just have a celebration meal together. And all these years later, I just remember that, what that meant, to be together and just to celebrate God's presence. So when we think about our faith and God being the source of love, in today's scripture, Jesus talks about God's love. He shares God's commandments. Commandments are a law, after all, aren't they? But then Jesus shows us how to apply those laws to our everyday living. That is how God, who is the source of love, uses instructions, commands to guide us in our living. So when I think about these Valentines, are they finished products here? No, there's some work to be done on it, isn't there? Well, it has to be, what, David, would you say, cut out, first of all, there. Yeah, and get the heart shape there. And then they're blank. That's not good, is it, there? So I want to think about what we could put on those as well. And so that's what I'm hoping you'll be doing in your breakfast club today there, is you will be not only shaping these Valentines, it reminds me how God shapes our lives, how God's teachings shape our everyday living. In other words, we just don't learn the commands and laws to talk about on Sunday morning where we're supposed to apply them to our lives. And then I'd like to challenge you just to think about some verses in Scripture that you might write here, and you can Google that. Just think about where in the Bible does it talk about love. In fact, one verse in particular in 1 John 4, God is love. That would be appropriate for there. And so if you would put that on the Valentines. Now, what do we do with these Valentines? Do we just keep them to ourselves? It wouldn't be much. No, exactly. We give it to someone. And so that's where I need your help. If you in these next few minutes could work on these Valentines, and then if you could give them back, I'm going to take them myself and along with Deacon Helen when we go about our visits of the week at Asbury and with other folks in our congregation, we'll be able to deliver these Valentines. And do you see what you've done? We've been reminded of God's love, and we celebrate that, God's love for each of us, and now we are sharing that love with others. That's the true gift that we can offer this world, and our world so needs it. So I invite you now, and Lauren, can I call upon you here to hand out our help me hand out the Valentines as you go forth, and I promise to deliver them for you. Okay. Thank you all for coming up today. We have one for
A special day in the life of the church is a day in which we celebrate our scouting ministries. I'm just curious, how many do we have here amongst us today who have been involved in scouting ministry at one time or another? Would you just indicate, wow, do you see this wonderful ministry that surrounds us here? Thank you. I am so thankful for our connection as a church with scouting ministry and for these ministries that have touched so many lives as we just celebrate the fact your good work in our nation and in our world. The ministry of scouting, we are so thankful that we can be connected with this with the church. And please know that we keep you in our prayers as you go about this important work in our world. Thank you for being part of scouting, and so glad that the United Methodist Church continues in our role of supporting the scouting ministries. One way that we can do that is through our prayers. So at this time, I'd like to invite you to join me in offering aloud this prayer for our scouting ministries all over the world. Let us pray together. O God, your will is that all your children should grow into fullness of life. We lift to you the ministry of scouting. We offer you thanks for camping to teach us that the world is our great home, for study and work to build character, for service to see our responsibility to those in need, for encouragement and genuine patriotism and vital faith. Bless the work of scouting in this place and all around the world, that through its efforts, the young may, like our Lord, increase in wisdom and in stature and in favor with you and all people. Amen. At this time, I invite all who are able to please stand as Storm shares with us this morning our gospel lessons.
Morning, everybody. I'll be reading this morning from Matthew chapter 5, verses 21 through 37. You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, "You shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment." But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, "You fool," you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you're offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are on the way to court with him, or your accuser may hand you over to the judge and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly, I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You've heard that it was said, "You shall not commit adultery." But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. If your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go into hell. It was also said, "Whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce." But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of unchastity, causes her to commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, "You shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord." But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thank you, Storm. I invite you to pray with me. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the opportunity to reflect, to go deeper in our understanding of your word. Just as your Holy Spirit first worked to bring about the word, so it takes your Holy Spirit to work in this time of interpretation. Thank you, O God, for yours being a living word. We pray that through this time of reflection,
that each of us will be able to draw what we need from your teaching and apply it to our daily living. Bless and use this time to your glory, we pray, in Christ's holy name. Amen. So today we conclude our series in the glimpses of the kingdom of God with today, but I say Jesus' words. So we've been looking at the Sermon on the Mount. This is our third Sunday looking at this text, and we've just begun to scratch the surface when it comes to reflecting on this powerful sermon. And so I invite you to go back to Matthew chapter 5 and use that as part of your devotion. That could be a great devotion during Lent, by the way, to just reflect on this Sermon on the Mount, to go deeper in your discipleship. One book I do not recommend that you read during this season is entitled the following, and that is, What is the Least I Can Believe and Still Be a Christian? That is like the opposite of what Jesus has to say in the Sermon on the Mount. But it is a temptation that we face in this world. We find ourselves always looking for the easy way, and sometimes even in the church. Oh, we'll just make it easy for you to join the church. No big deal. Now, we do try to make certain practices easier. That's part of what we are doing as a church, always refining. For example, I am so grateful to Heidi and for her work on our webpage. I invite you to check that out when you can, graceumc.org. I often tell our staff, our webpage is the front porch to our church. Perhaps some of you found your way to this service through looking at that. And so we try to make it easier for you to navigate that. In fact, later in the service, when it comes to our offering, we're now going to have a barcode up there where you'll be able to enter your giving right where you're sitting or right where you're at. I tried it from my phone yesterday. So making it easier so you know when you come to church where to park or what time we're gathering or where is the sanctuary once you're in the building. These are all important that we do this. But when it comes to faith, when it comes to our practice, our development as Christians, like most anything else in life that's worthwhile, you have to work at it. Do you think the players playing in the game later today are going to pick up the football for the first time since they set it down at the last game? No. They've been working at it. They've been practicing. Do you think our scouts start out with Eagle Scout awards or with all the pins that we see them wear on their uniforms? No, that's something that they work at. And so we are called to work at our faith as well, to grow as Christians, our Christian formation. And I believe that's what Jesus is teaching us in this passage. And I really want you to stay with me on this, because if you just read that on your own, you think, what's he saying? Plucking an eye out or cutting a hand off? And no, let's go deeper is what Jesus invites us to do. The Reverend Derek Weber put it this way in reflecting on this passage. He said, Jesus started this sermon with blessings for the struggling, encouragement for the blessed, and is describing the high calling of kingdom citizenship. We are still in that spirit when we gather in his name. Living the way that Jesus is describing will be like nothing anyone has ever seen or outlined even today. That's the exciting journey that he's inviting us to. As we consider each of the different scenarios and actions addressed, we also need to look beyond them to the kind of character, Christian formation again, character building, that should and needs to be taking place in each of our lives. I used to have an economics professor who said, we used to tell him, you're so smart. He said, the more I learn, the more I find out I don't know. And that's so true in our journey. We are all still learning. So let's take each of these scenarios. Jesus pulls them right from the commandments, for example, and see where he takes them. You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not murder. And whoever murders shall be liable to judgment. There you go. But see where he goes with it now. Murder isn't just a literal exterior act.
We can also have a murderous spirit that shows up in our speech, our attitude, our thoughts about and treatment of others. See how Jesus takes us to the next level? Not just, oh, I don't murder. Of course you don't. But see, where do we bring harm? In our words, in our posts, in our gossip, in our thoughts and treatment of others. He takes another commandment about adultery. He says, you've heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. See where he goes with this? Adultery isn't just something that is physically committed. An adulterous disposition leers at others in order to take and selfishly consume without regard. With all the gathering in Arizona, sadly, there'll be sex trafficking there as well in this time. Treating others in horrible ways we see happening not just in faraway places, but in Montgomery County where we're at and in the counties where you live. He takes another commandment. About oaths. Again, you've heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord, one of the laws. But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God. A similar meaning is seen in Jesus' teaching about oath-taking. God's people don't need to use oaths because they ought to already be committed to telling the truth. You don't need to be saying, oh, I swear on a stack of Bibles, or I promise you it's the truth. No, we should always be about the truth. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, after all. Seeking to follow Jesus in our everyday living. To be committed to telling the truth. That is ours to know and to own this day. So, with that in mind, let us see how God's word needs to be urgently applied to our living today. Not just something we leave to Sunday morning or to our childhood or to our confirmation class. Notice the urgency here in this passage. So when you are offering your gift, you're right in the middle of church service. When you're offering your gift at the altar, and if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gifts there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother or sister and then come and offer your gift. The importance of reconciliation, of not letting anger cloud us from living out God's vision. The great artist, Leonardo da Vinci, was working on the painting he's famous for, The Last Supper. He became very angry with a certain man. Losing his temper, he lashed the man with bitter words and threats. Returning to his canvas, he attempted to work on the face of Jesus, but was unable to do so. Finally, he put down his brush, sought out the man, and asked his forgiveness. The man accepted his apology, and Leonardo was able to return to his workshop and finish painting the face of Jesus. Do you see what dealing with his anger meant? How he is once again able to literally focus on Jesus. But what might that mean for you? What are you harboring in your heart this day? Now remember what we said in looking at this sermon. There are times we should be angry. There are situations that should anger us in our world. I loved how Professor Dale Bruner put it this way when he reflected on anger. He said, experiencing anger is not a sin in itself, but choosing to remain angry when working toward forgiveness or reconciliation is possible, that is a sin. In the end, when holding on to anger becomes a habit, like holding on to and acting on lust, we become addicted to it, and it consumes us. When what we want is to be consumed by is the kindness and mercy of God. Again, faith isn't something you can leave here, but to be consumed by God's mercy, by God's kindness, to the point that it influences everything we do and everything that we say. This is how the effect of God's law can continue to work in and through our lives. So often we think about, and some think from the outside, I'm sure, think about Christianity, oh, it's all those laws that you have to follow. You won't have any fun if you become a Christian. Well, I, for one, have known a lot of joy. As I'm fond of saying, I've never met the person who's sorry they gave their life to Christ. I've met a lot of people in ministry who are sorry that they didn't do it sooner. There's so much joy to experience. God wants us to know this joy. That's why Jesus is saying these words to his followers. It's not enough just to check off the laws, but see what the law that he fulfills, remember from last week, does for us. I love this account of a childhood friend, Frank. Frank was about 8 years old at the time. Okay. He started arguing with his sister, and I mean it was an argument. Before long, arguing turned into pushing and shoving, and soon enough, Frank had his younger sister pinned to the ground with his fist raised in the air. At that moment, his mother came into the room and told him to stop it. In response, Frank, as he described, reared up as only an 8-year-old can and declared, fist still raised in the air, she's my sister. I can do anything I want to her. Well, at this point, Frank's mom swooped across the room, towered over him, and said, she's my daughter. No, you can't. That's the law at work. God's gift to protect and care for God's children. I know we at times feel the negative impact or threat of the law, but it's because God cares so deeply about God's children, all of God's children. No, you can't hoard everything. No, you can't discriminate and exclude. No, you can't violate and exploit, because she is my daughter and he is my son. That is what Jesus is teaching us. That's what Jesus is doing when he fulfills God's law. That's what we celebrate in this time. How Jesus, but I say to you, oh, what does Jesus have to say to you this day? Are you listening? Don't be put off by the law. Notice how it can apply to our everyday life. Again, look at what he says about adultery here. You've heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. Okay. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. And this is where you can't take the word literally. We believe it to be an inspired word, okay? God working through the word, the Holy Spirit word. Because when you read this, if your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It's better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. Or if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It's better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go into the hell. He's not talking about harming yourself. He's not talking about mutilation here. He's talking about transformation that God brings to our work and brings to our households. It's more than you don't commit adultery. It's about working at your marriage, feeding your marriage. I tell couples when we plan their wedding, don't let your wedding day be the highlight of your marriage. But you build upon that, and that's what we're called to do. Pope Francis used this description when he wrote a letter to married couples. He wrote the following. He repeated a refrain he had so often used when meeting with families and married couples, listing the three most important words in a marriage: please, thanks, and sorry. Picking up the theme in his remarks to the tourists and passerbys at St. Peter's Square, Francis said a failure to make peace before going to bed at night can lead to a cold war the next morning. How many times, unfortunately, conflicts originate within the domestic walls due to the prolonged periods of silence and from unchecked selfishness, he said. Sometimes it even ends up in physical and moral violence. This lacerates harmony and kills the family. He urged families to put down their cell phones at the dinner table and talk. He urged parents to think not of themselves but others and to pray for the gift of peace. Oh, what might that look like in your marriage, with your partners, with your significant others, in your households, if we really put down the phones at dinner and listened to one another, if we expressed our love to one another, if we encouraged one another, if we listened to one another. Sadly, there are times that divorce takes place. You shouldn't stay where you are being abused. The church is there to support you if you are going through such a storm. But where there's opportunity to feed and grow a relationship, Christ is there to fulfill, to interpret God's law. And this is work that needs to be done today. Too often, we want to take the easy road. Too often, we measure up pretty good when we compare ourselves to others. One of my favorite theologians that I'm coming to appreciate her work more and more is Caroline Lewis. She says, "You've heard it said, but I say to you, as a homiletic all of its own, casting a vision for what could be when most are satisfied with what is." We cannot become satisfied with what is, not in our life together as a church. God is providing us so many wonderful opportunities to be reaching out, to be offering community. We cannot become satisfied with where we are at, with what is. Lewis, in her own pain, shares the following. She said, "I've shared with you the passing of my father this past September. He was not a perfect man. None of us are. But he had a hunger for righteousness and a thirst for justice. One of the most meaningful moments in his last 8 months of life happened in June when he received the Clarence Anderson Award for Peace and Justice. He was honored with this award for his ministry with AIDS patients during the AIDS crisis of the late 1980s and early 90s. As a founding member of the AIDS Project Los Angeles, my dad offered compassion and care, spiritual accompaniment, assisted with funeral arrangements, and conducted memorial services when the world and the church were in denial about the AIDS crisis. As I was thinking about, you have heard it said, but I say to you, and its embedded homiletic, here's how I started to hear Jesus' words. When few clergy would volunteer, my dad said, but I say to you. When the church abandons you, my dad said, but I say to you. When the world tells you that you're going to hell, my dad said, but I say to you. But I say to you, cast the net of God's love wider than we would typically allow. But I say to you, presses us to extend the arc of righteousness beyond the reasonable. But I say to you, names the truths of the injustices all around us, but yet invites us to hope nonetheless." And that's our message that we bring. We as the church, as Christians, we have the message of hope to offer a world that is so hurting, so searching for meaning. Buying into the hallmark of the Valentines, when there is a greater love to be our source in our marriages, in our life of singleness, in our lives and our communities. And that source is Jesus Christ, who avails ourselves, and we offer Christ in our service to others. The injustices, we don't have time to name them in this world, but the opportunities to serve and be a witness of Christ, that's our service that we can offer. Amanda Janine Adams shared the following. She was talking about teams of students at Rhodes College who joined together in what's known as a Micah 6 partnership with local congregations. They work creatively toward the prophetic vision, as you know in Micah 6, to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with God. Micah 6 is a creative way for students to connect with local congregations in Memphis for outreach ministries. And we know the horrible events that have taken place with the killing of Tyree Nichols in Memphis. It's encouraging to hear of this kind of work. Amanda led a Micah 6 team to organize a new urban scouting program for young girls in downtown Memphis. "I was pushed and challenged to think deeply about my service and its purposes in life," Through this questioning of actions, I began a spiritual exploration, an ongoing process that has allowed me to grow in faith and as a result grow as a servant. I soon realized that service was not just something I happened to do. Service was something I was called to do. When Jesus extends these teachings from the law and the prophets, Jesus is inviting us to live out, to respond to God's call that is extended to each and every one of us in our life together. It is transforming. God is at work in our world today. Now, I could take a poll and see how many Chief fans we have here today. I could take a poll and see how many Eagle fans we have today. And it would be interesting to see how many of you are just going to watch for the commercials that are going to take place today and won't lose any sleep over the game. But it is a historic moment in time. In this Black History Month, for the first time, two African-American men will be the quarterbacks for the opposing teams, Patrick Mahomes and Jalen Hurts. I grew up near Canton, Ohio, where football originated and where it is part of life there. And I can remember growing up when there were not any black quarterbacks in the NFL or even the major college teams. This is transformative. This is progress, and we must celebrate that. And what I also celebrate about these two men is their faith. All you have to do is Google their names. And in the first paragraph that you read about them, they will share that they are Christians. They will talk about their Christian faith and how here they are at the pinnacle of their career. They are where few people get to when it comes to football. They are starting quarterbacks in the Super Bowl, and yet they point to Jesus Christ being more important and how faith in him keeps them grounded. Can you imagine the temptations that must come their way? And yet they find strength and guidance and purpose not in the acclaim of others, but in faith in Jesus Christ. And that's what we celebrate as Christians. Now, no matter who wins, no matter what spectacular feats they accomplish on the field tonight, I think the story that we are going to take away from this season and many seasons is the story of Damar Hamlin. Damar Hamlin was the young man who suffered cardiac arrest a few weeks ago on the field and is making this remarkable recovery. He made a surprise appearance. Maybe you saw it at an award show earlier this week, and I loved what he had to say. He said, "I want to thank God for even being here." And then he said, "One of my favorite quotes is, 'A blessing to be a blessing.'" Now, I've used that often. We are blessed to be a blessing, but I love how he says it there. With that being said, I plan to never take this position for granted and always have an urgent approach to making a difference in the community where I come from and also communities across the world. It is a blessing to be a blessing. We are blessed, and it is a blessing to be called by God, and that call extends to all of us, and we have an opportunity to extend God's love, to be a blessing. And so I give you these challenges as we go forth. Christian formation is a lifetime process. What steps can you take this week to grow in your discipleship? Secondly, Jesus warns of unresolved anger between family members and calls for a concrete act of reconciliation. What steps towards reconciliation can you take this week? Amanda Janine Abrams stated, "I soon realized that service was not just something I happened to do. Service was something I was called to do." And lastly, reflect on what ministry service you are being called to serve Christ and others through. And lastly, as we reflect on Damar Hamlin's words, it's a blessing to be a blessing. How are you blessed to be a blessing? May we be open. As Jesus says to us, "But I say to you," what does he have to say to you and to me this day? May we be listening. Amen. Today, as I mentioned during our offering, you see, for those of you online, and even right here, we have the barcode that will take you right to our online giving. Now, you give in whatever way you want to. We still offer offering envelopes. We were passing the plates shortly. But we celebrate these ways that we can be part of God's work in the world. So if you take a moment to scan that, and we'll be offering that visual each week so that you will have it, may we give thanks that we have the opportunity to participate in God's work. Amen. And now at this time, for our offertory, we will hear from our bell choir. Thank you. Holy God, as we offer to you the gifts from the abundance you have provided us, we recognize that the offering that concerns you is more than what is in our wallets and purses, but in our hearts. You desire from us hearts that are a fit place for you to live and dwell. Help us to clear out long-held anger, resentments, prejudice, and hate. Help us to furnish our hearts with love, mercy, justice, compassion, and forgiveness, so they might be a place where you feel welcome and at home. Help us present this offering as well. In Jesus we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Let us continue in prayer. Lord, we thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity to gather in your name. For it's in your name that we find purpose, that we find power, that we can be present, truly present for you and for one another. Lord, you are at work in our lives even as I speak and as we pray. Already a hug has been shared, a word of encouragement has been made, a song has truly touched our hearts, because we have been reminded of your abiding presence. Lord, it's true. Morning has broken, not just through the beauty of the sunrise, but truly a new day is unfolding because you are here, breathing new life into us, causing us and stirring us and agitating us to a point where we're not comfortable or satisfied with where we're at, but rather contemplating, prayerfully discerning our next steps in you. For those who are here for the first time, may it be the first of many, many times of hearts opening to you in worship and of lives being transformed. And for those of us here who have been doing this for a long time, may it be a day of new beginning as well, recognizing that we are not finished, that at times we confess we have given in to taking the easier path. For the challenges and for your willingness to be with us in the challenges we face, we thank you. Whether they are the challenges of personal health concern, whether it's the injustice in our world, whether it's the overwhelming numbers of those who have been lost to earthquake, Lord, as your heart breaks, our hearts break as well. We pray, O God, and give thanks for those who are there on the scene, still rescuing, comforting, helping, being the hands and feet of Christ. Help us, O God, in our own ways to support these ministries and to offer ministries of caring right where we live. Help us to apply your word, and to remember that you have a word for us each and every day if we but listen. Where there's brokenness in our homes, where there's grief, maybe somebody's facing a Valentine's the first time not having their soulmate here. Comfort them. Lord, we thank you for the value of every life. May all be reminded that we are included in your love, that ever-growing circle that you call us to be extending. For the personal concerns we carry, and for the ministries that await us as a church bound together, continue to breathe new life into us as we offer the prayer that you have given us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite all who are able to please stand as we join in singing hymn number 420, Breathe on Me, Breath of God.
Thank you.
Please be seated. So as we go forth, I remind you of our challenges for this week, and these will appear in grace notes as well. Christian formation is a lifetime process. What steps can you take this week to grow in your discipleship? Secondly, Jesus warns of unresolved anger between family members and calls for a concrete act of reconciliation. What steps towards reconciliation can you take this week? Amanda Janine Abrams stated, "I soon realized that service was not just something I happened to do. Service was something I was called to do." Reflect on what ministry service you are being called to serve Christ and others through. And lastly, reflect on Damar Hamlin's words, "It's a blessing to be a blessing." How are you being blessed to be a blessing? Now as we go forth, when Jesus said, "But I say to you," he was raising the bar. He was calling for more than the law requires. He was calling us to righteousness. Let us go from here determined to follow his call by the Spirit's grace and live as disciples every moment of our lives. Go with God. Amen.